Dear Father God in heaven, I want to thank you for the many blessings in which you have bestowed on this body of Mosaic. In the transition in which we have gone through over the past year, moving from the old building to the new building, Father God, I ask that you stay steadfast in the hearts of Mark and Harry and the rest of the leadership team, and that we can carry out your visions and plans, not only for the 72204 zip code, Conway, and around America and the rest of the world in which you have planted Mosaic, people of Mosaic at. These things we ask in your name, amen.
Thank you, Anthony. You know, the elders are awesome. And this is normally Mark's part, but he's in Dallas getting that conference ready. They've already started with all their pre-conference stuff, and so I'm filling in for him on this next couple slides. But there's a few things that we wanted you to be aware of about this last year, kind of give you a state of how things are going, where we ended up. Eli's going to come up and give a kind of like where we ended up physically from the last year. I think he's here somewhere. Oh, there he is. Thankfully, he's here. But I really wanted to encourage you with some tremendous testimonies of some different people that are doing ministry out of here. But as you know, we have announced before how when the elders go away on our retreats, that we came away with three big key items. And they were evangelism, discipleship, and organizational excellence. Okay, and the first two, you know, we are always working on those. But we really wanted to continue being a little more strategic about how we reach people and how we grow them up. And so you'll see some things coming up here. Hopefully you continue to see ministries that focus on those two aspects. And you'll hear some things. I'll show you some more things here in a minute. Now the third one, the organizational excellence, is probably not one you're going to see a lot of, but hopefully you'll feel, okay? Even in some of the stuff we're going to present to you today, like the fact that we now, every time a penny is given to the church, we track it from the moment it comes into the church to the moment it goes out of the church. So Rafa has just done an outstanding job. He is a super a gift to this body in terms of his financial mind, his detail orientation. He doesn't let a single penny go through his books without it being accounted for. And that is great. I'm so happy about that. And there's other areas that we're working on that. But there's a few things you may have seen or may not have seen or heard that I want to make sure to clarify. Mark, remember last year, Mark announced that he had received funding to do his Mosaic work outside of the church, around the country, through a very gracious church in North Carolina that wanted to have the same exact vision he had for planting multi-ethnic churches. So he's released much of his salary, and I can't remember the latest numbers, but definitely less than 40%. Okay, so he's getting funded mostly outside, and his role here is definitely changing. But as a result of that salary release, we were able to hire Alex and Kai and Maria. And, you know, that's how all that money kind of got shifted around. And there were some other things that happened that allowed us to make those hires. So that was like number one. And then number two, we moved Mike from connections to executive pastor. Okay, so Mike's functions will be largely overseeing at a very high level the finances, because we figured that was one area that needed more oversight since Rafa was doing the book so well. And then HR functions for the staff and facilities kinds of things. And so Mike, you know, is extremely capable in areas that involve tactics, and he's always thinking about those things that I never think about, thank God, you know. And then as a result, Mark and I have been working so long together. It's almost like we think a lot alike. And so now, basically, my role here is largely to run the church day to day. Okay, so I've moved from campus pastor to senior pastor, with whatever that means. But what it really means is that I'm the one that's usually here, and I'm usually the one running things on a daily basis. So those things hopefully will help strengthen the church, and hopefully you may not necessarily see it, but you will hopefully feel it more as we become more focused on organizational excellence. So that's the key initiatives from the elders. I also wanted to just show you, when I became senior pastor, I thought, you know, what are the things that I need to start measuring? And so, you know, we're not really good about counting around here, right? I mean, it took us probably, 7 or 8 years before we started actually taking attendance numbers. You know, somebody would sit in the back and actually count people in the service. It just took us a long time because we've never been focused on things like that. But we have been counting for a while, and for the first 3 quarters of this year, attendance across both campuses is up almost 40%. Okay, and thanks be to God for that, right? It's not the end all, it's just an indicator. And for Little Rock alone, when we compare these 9 months, month to month to last month, they're up anywhere from 25 to 40%. It may not necessarily feel like it because now we're doing two services as opposed to one, but there's a good number of people in the first service, and a lot of times the first service rivals the second service in terms of numbers. And so it may, you know, may feel like it's not as big as across the street when we were all together, but that's what the numbers tell us. So we're thankful for that. And here's another thing I wanted you all to know, is just how the building's being used. We're basically doing stuff every day. And Monday is the Antioch Initiative. That's where we're offering affordable, accredited college degrees and also Bible study at the same time. It's a citywide effort. There's a bunch of churches involved, and we are leading the third cohort out of like 4 or 5 now that are meeting all around the city, and it's a unified effort that targets the urban core of a city in terms of all the projects and practicums associated with the degree. But it's a really exciting program and one that we're really happy to be a part of. Tuesday, of course, is packed. We got the Orchard Chess Club, Fresh to You, and there's a Latino Bible study that meets here on Tuesdays. Wednesdays, MSM and Soul Sisters. And you should really, if you get a chance, come on Wednesday night and see what Kai's got going on. It is amazing. He's not speaking today, but he's going to be speaking tonight about all that God is doing in their midst. And we're seeing God do some amazing things in the students' lives. Thursday, Worship Arts, Teen Mops, and you'll hear more from Trisha in a minute. And you'll also hear from Georgia from the Chess Club and from Gail from the Orchard. Friday, we're closed. But we are open as needed, so if there's ever an event, you know, we'll open up the building. Saturday, did you know that there is a music school that meets here? They've got over almost 40 students. He told me, I think, 38 last count. But it's a very affordable way to learn music, and it's they teach 5 different instruments, and they're packing it out. We have hopes in the future for doing like a language school. And also we're considering being a warming center for the homeless community. So there's lots and lots of opportunities going forward to even expand beyond that. And then of course on Sundays is all ministries, all hands on deck. So make no mistake about it, this building is not sitting empty most of the week. It is actually, probably if anything, you know, we're being used a lot and we're getting a lot of calls. You know, we're hosting the Asian Festival again next weekend, and there's people that want to rent different aspects of the building. So you just pray, because we want to be wise stewards, Right? And remember what Mark always says, that his, one of his favorite proverbs is, where the stalls are clean, there are no oxen. So we like the fact that our building is definitely lived in and being used, especially by the community. And there's a ton of stories that you'll hear coming up about how the community sees us. Check this out. I just went around and asked people, who are the partners in our ministries? Some of these are people giving us very substantial dollars. Others are donating services. Still others are donating food or volunteers. But look at that. They're governmental, they're educational, they're churches, they're businesses. There's virtually almost every kind of entity you can think of is involved with us at some level, which is really neat. I just have never seen a church be such a hub for so many different kinds of things like this. And especially when I've talked to other churches, we have churches that are really, really doctrinally conservative that like working with us, and we have churches that are very, very theologically liberal and that love working with us. And so it's like, we're just, I don't know, it's just who God made us. We're appealing to all people. And I forgot to mention, like, the 10 Fitness. You guys know there's a homeless ministry once a month on Sunday nights. They close early. And there's a good group of homeless people that go in there every Sunday night. They get to take showers, they get food, they get clothes. And there's a lot of people from here that volunteer there. So it's just a neat thing to see, and that list keeps growing. Here's another one. This isn't just necessarily sponsorships. This is just ways that Mosaics are being used by God to bring the city together. So like that Baptist Health one, the first Tuesday of every month, we become an official community wellness center. So it's part of the Orchard, and they have bring nurses in, and they're fabulous. And Pat was instrumental in getting that here. And they do blood tests. They do all kinds of free testing. You get a free flu shot. I mean, it's just like stuff that is saving the community hundreds of dollars if they needed medical, some kind of medical screening. But it's here every first Tuesday, you know, and then just look at all the different ways that God is using us to bring people together under the cross of Christ. That last one there, Race Under Grace, we've only had it here 2 weeks, but there's probably 50 to 60 pastors and leaders just sitting around tables discussing ways to discuss race in the church. And, you know, just training, because everybody's like, how do we do this? What do we do? And so it's just good influence. You know, and they said, we could think of no other place we wanted to have this than Mosaic, you know. And so it's just what God is up to, but we thank God for just how he's using us in that regard. And I wanted you to hear from three powerful voices this morning, and I've asked Mike, if he would, to do some interviews for you on these.
Thank you, Harry. Danny and I first came to Mosaic 10 years ago. 2 years later, we were invited to join the staff. So we've been on staff for 8 years, and I wish 10 years ago I had begun logging all the firsts. That's the first time that's ever happened, you know, those kind of moments. And I had one today. We're a church that demonstrates the gospel, and this morning we were asked to do puppy triage this morning. I don't know if you're here for the 9 o'clock service. One of the homeless guys had this beautiful little 8-week-old Labrador puppy that got into a fight with a bigger dog. And this morning he brings the puppy to us and says, can you help? And we're like, need a vet, you know. Don't know of any vets in our church, but I think the puppy's going to be okay. Looked like he was a little traumatized, but another first in my Mosaic life this morning. Well, you know, since the beginning, as Harry said at the closing of the second service, that we believe the gospel is part demonstration as well as part proclamation. And The Orchard was one of the first ministries that ever began in our church. And it started at this mobile home park, which had Mosaic's very first property that we owned, which was a mobile home in Alexander. And we began the Orchard there. And I'm going to ask Gail Jackson to come up here. And I'll also in a few minutes have Tricia Goyer come talk about Teen Mops. And Georgia Morris is here to talk about the Chess Club. I thought I would switch up a little bit and talk to Gail. The most exciting thing in my exchange with Gail this past week was that Gail keep referring to Mosaic as our church, and I love that. Gail is fairly new to the Orchard ministry. She's been coming as a volunteer. Dana had told her about it in a Bible study that she has with at Fellowship Bible, where Gail is a member, and Gail said, I got to come. If you've ever known anybody with the gift of evangelism, this one right here stands in the top 10% of that. And we believe that the Orchard is where the lowest hanging fruit is for our ministry. It's the kind of ministry where you can share the gospel and they are ready to hear it and receive it. And Gail, you have had some amazing experiences in the short time this year that you've been a part of the Orchard. And why don't you share with us about one of those?
Okay, you hold the mic because I'll use my hands. Okay, I guess the first thing, the first person that comes to my mind is a girl by the name of Tamara. And we have stayed in contact with her, and I think we've seen her grow. And it's been such a blessing. And I see Rick back there, and I'll probably use your name. I didn't get permission, but I think that's okay, isn't it, Rick? He's my bodyguard. But Tamara came, and when I first saw her, she was just sitting like this, and I was walking around. Rick always tells them that he will pray and that I'm the prayer lady. And so I saw her, and I went up to her, and she says, well, don't get close to me because I know I stink and I've had these clothes on. I said, that's okay. I don't care. And we started praying. I found out if she knew the Lord. And she says, I'm not sure. And she started telling me her situation. Well, I started sharing the gospel with her. And we got down to the end. And I asked her. She says, no, I know. I want Jesus. And so I led her through the prayer, when I was sharing with her, I did say the prayer of salvation because I just didn't believe. But anyway, she accepted Christ, and so when I started talking to her, I just got closer and closer to her, and I said, now you are somebody. I said, Tamara, you don't belong in the woods. You weren't raised like this. You've got to get out of this. You're somebody now. And the more I told her, the stronger her back got up, and she started raising up. I said, you look at your blood now. You're a king. You're a daughter of the King of Kings, and you are forgiven. And all of that is in the past. And she said, yes, I am. And the devil's giving me a tickle. And so then, when the next Tuesday, lo and behold, here comes this beautiful girl with all of this hair, this black hair. She doesn't have black on. She's got summer clothes on. And she says, they told me I could volunteer here. And I'm going to work back here with y'all. She says, you remember me? And I said, you're Tamara. She said, yes, I am. And she says, and by the way, I don't have a name tag. She says, get me one. But listen to what she said, because I'm somebody. And I said, yes, you are. Tomorrow has got two jobs, and she's moved into her own apartment.
Praise the Lord.
So that's probably one of our, and it was a team effort, and so has Joy. Y'all all know who Joy is. She has stayed in contact, and we're going to see her Wednesday and get permission to share this story.
Now, we were closed this past week, but the Orchard the previous week, you said that you had an experience that happened there that you thought was really cool.
Yes, a guy came in, and his name was Johnny, and a great big tall guy. And I think Brother Rick, you shared with him some too. But he came in the door, and when he came in, he was just so tall. And now he was not homeless. He had he had a home. And I looked at him, and he said from the minute he walked through the door of the orchard, he felt peace and he felt love. And he said, I knew when I got through, I was going to be okay. So I looked at him and I said, well, how are you? And he said, I'm not good at all. I am so depressed. He said, now, I'm a Christian. And he said, but I'm still so depressed. So I said, well, I'll get to you as soon as I can. And I think I told Mike that right behind me was a girl this lady had brought. And she said, well, she just got out of jail. You're going to have to talk to her first. And so I did. And he kept looking at me. He was watching me because he wanted me to talk to him. Long story short, I prayed with him over his depression. We plead the blood of Jesus over his mind, over his emotions. He'd say, write that down, write that down. I don't know if I can remember that. I said, can you remember to sing Jesus Loves Me? He said, yes. I said, can you remember the song, There's Power in the Blood? He said, yes. And I said, then I want you to write down Revelations 12, 11. And it says, and they overcome him, overcome Satan by the word of the Lamb. And that is through the blood of Jesus. And boy, if you want to get a blessing, get a choir singing, they overcome by the blood of the Lamb. And you'll see this sister just about shout, because that is that scripture. And I said, and you sing, there's power in the blood. And you keep doing that till it leaves. Cheryl told me, I shared this Wednesday night, and Cheryl that does our boxes, she says, you won't believe this. When he came through, he said, I'm going to be singing, there's power in the blood, and Jesus loves me till I die. And went on, and then, I'm going to go real fast because I'm going to tell two more. Can I?
One more.
Okay, then I'm going to tell the one of you. There's a man. First of all, I want to share a scripture. This is why that I know the Lord brought me here. I thought he brought me here to be with my grandchildren. But I've been sharing the gospel since 1975. And I had not found an outlet here. And then, like he said, Dana plugged me in here. And I'm getting to do this. I'm getting to do this. And this is my life verse. It is, let me read it to you. If I have to do this, or I'll ramble from now on. This is what Jesus said when he said, you clothed me when I was naked. And they said, well, no, we didn't do that. I don't remember that. This is why I work at the orchard, and I think everybody in here does. As he said, surely I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to the one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it unto me. And when I hold those faces of those women, and they feel like they're nobody, and they don't want me to even get close to them, they say, well, I smell, and I just hold them because I know that I'm doing this unto Jesus. And you give the gospel to somebody that has no hope. They have no hope because most people don't want to even be around them. But not the orchard, not this staff. And there's one man that comes in all the time. And I have shared with him a lot, but you know what he always says before he goes home? Can you go get Mike? Can you go get Mike? And Mike comes. He says the same thing this guy does every time to Mike. I've never seen Mike frustrated with him. He just stands there, says the same thing, goes through the same scriptures, knows he's not going to give up his sin because he's not going to do it. He's been doing the same thing. Mike never puts him down because he loves him. And he knows when he comes in there, he's safe. He's safe because Jesus is there. The unlovely can come to the orchard and let us love on them. The whole place is full of love, and when they come in there, and then the Lord lets me, of all people, sit down and share the plan of salvation. Woo!
If you're part of the orchard, would you stand up so we can... If you serve in the orchard team at any time, just stand up. If you're one of the volunteers, Dr. It's an amazing team, and they feel loved, there's no question. In 2010, God called a couple from the state of Montana to come to Little Rock. And little did we know when they ended up in Little Rock working at Family Life that God would call them to Mosaic. And Tricia Goyer and John Goyer were called here. And along with their incredible family, which is it quadrupled since then, I'm thinking? But But Tricia brought a heart for young moms to our church. And God had us ready to respond to teen mops here in 2010. Yes. Hard to believe. Tell us what's going on in teen mops here on Thursday nights at Mosaic.
I need Miss Jan to come up here too because she's my co-leader. This lady has been a blessing to me. She reminds me now, we need to do this for somebody. And she reminds me, we got to take care of this girl. And she sends me text messages. We meet every Thursday night at Teen Mops here from 6 o'clock till 7:30. And we have young moms from the age of 12 to about 25 would be average. Most of them around 19 or 20. And they come and they have dinner. They have us loving on them and checking on them. We have diapers, we have clothes for them, and then we have a speaker. And this year we're going through the book Teen Mom that I wrote, but it just talks about they're important and they have an identity and they can have hope in their future. And we just pour into them. They don't have anyone in their lives saying, you can be a good mom, you can make a difference. They're in school, they have people looking down on them. When they go out in the community, that they have people looking down on them, and we are here just to share hope and encouragement with these young women.
Well, there's stories everywhere, and I want you to just catch one thing she said. Moms from 12 years of age, tell us some of the stories that you're experiencing.
You know, we have, I'll share, one of the girls, Katie, has been coming 4 years, and she's there every week. She's so faithful. Recently, she started college. At the end of the year last year, we said, Katie, you know, we're setting goals for the year. What are you guys going to do during the summer? Well, we're apart. We don't meet during the summer. So, because when we come back, we're going to check on you. And so I'm like, Katie, what are you going to do? And she's like, I don't know. I'm like, you're going to sign up for college. Mm-hmm. Miss Tricia, I don't know if I could do that. I work. And I'm like, Katie, you're going to sign up for college. Me and Jan are going to sign up for college. About 3 weeks later, she texted me with her schedule that she signed up for college. So we're so thankful. And then she asked me to help her with one of her papers. So she emailed me her paper. You know what was on? It was on forgiveness. She was raised by an alcoholic mom. She talked about times when her mom would be passed out in the car and the police would come and knock on the window of the car and try to wake her mom up, and that God showed her that she needed to forgive. For God to forgive her, she needed to forgive. And that was her first college paper that she ever wrote, was on forgiveness. And then just this last week, she ended up getting married. So we're so thankful. So we see this, you see this progress, that they're hearing the gospel and then they're like, this applies to my life. This is not just something. But the 12-year-old, we've had, the Pulaski County contacted us, and they're sending girls court-ordered that have probation officers. They're now sending us to come to the meetings now because they need parenting classes. So they're court-ordered to come and hear about Jesus now.
Wow. Praise the Lord. One of the things that I will say is if Tricia Goyer can lead a ministry like Teen Mops and Mops with her house the way it is, I mean, I've been there. We call it the Goyer County Fair when we're at their house, you know. And there's so many kids, and they're just doing such a wonderful job. And we're so thankful that God brought you guys to Little Rock, to Mosaic. And Jan, you as well. Thank you for serving. And if you're involved in Teen Mop, stand up. Or you've been a speaker at one of their meetings. All right, there's one. Make note, we'll give you the roster. There's some people that can share with those moms in this room right now. Well, it was in November 2012 that we did a Discover Mosaic membership class, and it's happened occasionally, not often, but this young lady went through the class and got to the end and said, I just don't think God has me to join the church right now. And, you know, that always comes as a bitter pill, but you're like, you know, you put on your game face and go, well, good, okay, whatever God is leading you to do, and that's okay. And, but she said, I have this chess club, though, that is meeting at my church, and we're getting a little large, if I recall, and we need a larger place. Would you be open to doing it here? And I'm like, yeah, we'll do it here. Georgia Morris, come on up here. So Georgia's brought the chess club to our previous location, and it just began to grow and grow. And I think what else kind of grew on her was us, because Georgia finally came to me about a year later and said, I think God says he wants me to become a member. And so I'm thankful for that. But Georgia, you are leading. I just, from my perspective, it's probably one of the city's best chess club, maybe even the state's. And I know you see some amazing stories coming through there. I saw on Facebook the picture of all the chess club and many of their parents going to see the movie about the chess club the other day. There's one child, though, that has endeared to my heart by the name of Sierra. That's a part of your program. And tell us a little bit about Sierra before and Sierra after.
Sierra before. Well, actually, what I wanted to do is work with people in the community. The church that I was going to, I was actually working with kids that was very smart already. They had mothers, fathers. So they was all very smart. I didn't know anything about chess, but I met the Arkansas State champion, and he was trying to teach me, and I was like, oh no, this is too hard for me, but the kids may be able to learn this. And of course, I started Googling and trying to see what is chess is all about, and I started finding out that it helps kids, the strategy, it helps them in their math, their reading, and I was like, oh my God, I want to work with kids in the community. So one day I was over at Kroger's, my favorite shopping place, all my money. Okay, and I was shopping. I saw at the church, I saw somebody bringing out, it was on a Tuesday, and I saw all these people coming out with boxes of food. And this other lady that I didn't know, she also saw the people coming out. And I said, they doing something over there. They may be doing something for the community. So she said, I'm going to go over there and see. I said, yeah, you go, and I'm going to be right here when you get back. So she went over there, and she came back, and she said, well, they give boxes of food to people in the community, 72204 zip code. And so I was like, oh, they're doing something in the community. I'm going to go over there and start visiting them. Only thinking about my chess club and what God, I felt God had asked me to do is work in the community with kids that really needed me. So I started working with Tiffany and volunteering. I came over here for a couple of times, and then I met Tiffany, and they was working in Big Country Chateau. So I decided to volunteer with them. And then I saw these kids. These were the, I don't want to say the bad kids, but they were, I don't want to say nobody's bad, but they were just a little, thank you, okay. So I said, I'm going to start a chess club with these kids. So me, and then I said, it was a lady in the church, and she said she would help me. I was like, oh, good. We got those kids, and one day we was in the van with them, these kids, they was hollering, they was screaming, and I was like, oh no, I don't think I can handle this. And she said, and she told me that day, she said, I'm not coming back. I didn't sign up to volunteer for this. So I really didn't know what to do, but I felt God was still calling me, and Sierra was one of those kids. She was a teen lead, teen leader. So she was...
Let me share. I'll share about Sierra. The first children's Christmas musical, there was an entourage of children that came from Big Country to the former location. And what we didn't know at the end of the musical, it was a Sunday evening, right? So it was dark outside. And they had one adult caring for, I think there were 6 or 8 of these children who had come over. And what we didn't know was right after the play, they went over and got sugared up. We had punch and cookies and things like that. And then one thing led to another, and Sierra got angry at one of the children who were, and it became physical with her. And Harry was there, and we were both like, something is wrong with this child. She was so angry. And, I mean, it just became like we were herding them out of the building and trying to get them and over to Big Country. And I'll never forget seeing her in a parking lot with Harry, just kind of going, what was that? You know, it was just that intense. And it was a child who had some extra sugar and had really needed some good examples in her life. And tell us about Sierra today.
Sierra today, her grades has improved. She, last report card I saw, she has great A's and one B. Her behavior, just excellent. Even like I have talked to her, sometimes I go to the school just to visit them. I talk to the teacher there, and she said her behavior has changed. And you all know she comes to church with me. And that's another thing about Sierra, because I was asking them, why are these kids not coming to church? And they was like, well, they need to get a little better before they go to church. And then I thought about it, well, I don't need to be in church either. Look, if I'm gonna wait till I get better. But I started bringing Sierra to church with me and other kids that don't go to church. So I make sure that all my kids that don't go to church, they at least get at least one or two Sundays in church. But I make sure at the door, I tell them, don't let my name, their number flash on this big screen TV up here. I said, because I'm going in church and I'm going to enjoy. So far their names has not been. But one of the other things we do is I have volunteers, and I know if y'all don't volunteer to bring food or anything, just stand up now. So
you help with the chess club. Just go ahead and stand up if you've done anything to help with the chess club. Thank you.
Volunteers, is I have volunteers. They have volunteered to bring food, to be speakers. I have people outside of the church being speakers. Harry, I wanted to take them to the chess club. Pastor, I had them already figured up. My brother and my sister-in-law was going to do the popcorn, but I didn't know who was going to pay for the tickets. So one day, Harry sent me an email and said he wanted to take them all to this movie, The Queen of Cat Ray. Every chess club kid need to see it. I don't think Harry thought it was going to be 30 of us. 30 kids. And then Dale and Julie Dodson volunteered to pay for all the parents and the parents that came and the volunteers. So they went to the movies. These are people that you all, it's been awesome because I don't feel like it's me. I know it's just God moving through me because I'm just a little ordinary person, not nothing special here. But you all have been so wonderful, volunteering. Whenever I want something, I call, I ask somebody to speak. I got my calendar full of speakers for the kids, motivational speakers for the kids. And I'm going to tell you one more story than I, because it'll be so many. But one of the speakers was a youth pastor, a friend of mine's, a youth pastor. He was an RN, and he was a Navy officer. He came in and spoke to the kids. We had about 20 kids that night. And he said, after he got through talking about his job and what all he was doing, and so I was like, if anybody, because they kept asking questions, I said, if anybody wants to be a nurse, stay here and ask some more questions to him, but we got to get ready to go. It was about 5 kids that stayed. One of the little kids asked him, she said, but how do you, you know, I see you do all this. How do you make your money? She did not realize that you actually, because her mom is, you know, on food stamps and assistance. She did not realize that you make money by being a nurse. She wanted to know, how do you make your money? And when she came out later and told me, she said, Miss Georgia, I'm going to help people feel better and I'm going to make money.
Well, one of the things, how many do you have in church? Yeah, every Saturday night, Georgia invites separate sets of kids to come and spend the night with her so that they can end up here on Sunday morning. That's love. That's love. Georgia, thank you. Ooh. Well, Father, we just thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to just engage the community in these ways. And Lord, I thank you because these people are leaders that we are grateful for that you brought here. And Lord, just lengthen our tent stakes. We just want to do more because there's just so much more to do. And we do it in your name and for your glory. Amen. And let's see. Eli is going to come now and talk a little bit about money.
Thank you, Mike. Yes, sir, I did. But those were very encouraging stories. And the only thing I want to add is that all of you, when you volunteer, when you bring diapers, you know, when you bring snacks for the chess club, all of you are helping in your own way. And there's lots of people that help that are not even ever mentioned. Like Juan and Carmen, they'll come and cook breakfast for the pastors, and they'll show up and do a little presentation for the chess club and give them meals. So we really appreciate everything you do for those groups because it's very helpful. I'm going to be talking about money. Our fiscal year runs from September 1st through August 31st. So the numbers I'm going to be giving you are from September 1st, 2015 through August 31st, 2016. Okay. We have income from four broad categories: tithes and offerings, the building fund, staff support, and rental income. And I'm going to be talking about tithes and offerings in a minute, but I thought I'd give you some idea of where the other money comes from. Okay, and basically, we have about $109,000 that comes in from rental income, and that's a lot of that is 10 Fitness. They pay rent to us. We have another $113,000 that comes from support money. That money is really helpful to us. It takes some of the pressure off the church. So those of you that contribute to staff support, we really appreciate it. We have the building fund. $373,000 the last fiscal year, if you can believe it. That's a lot of money. Makes a big difference in our budget. So, tithe and offerings. You can see we've had a great, very blessed year. I think that citywide, there's a lot of churches that have like a 15-20% reduction in income. As you can see, we've had a very different picture. We've been trying to encourage everyone in the church to give consistently and generously, and it's reflected in these numbers. Little Rock went from $664,000 to $743,000, 12% increase. Conway, $143,000 to $156,000, 9% increase. The Mosaico, the Spanish venue, went from $10,000 to $13,000, 26% increase. And so overall, the offerings increased from $818,000 to $913,000, so 11.6% increase. So very encouraging. And the nice thing is the tithes and offerings are just 60% of total income. So all this other stuff, the rent, the support that comes in, is really what allows us to continue to meet our expenses. Okay. Our total income for the year, and this includes all the 100X giving, went from $1.5 million to $1,532,000. Now remember, this is all income altogether. That was down a little bit, about 3%, but we could not be happier with that number, because you guys have been so faithful. It's just been a great blessing. Our expenses went from $1.1 million to $1.2 million, about 100% deficit there. But again, we could not be happier because with the move to this new building, you know, we're not a renter anymore, we're an owner, so we had all kinds of expenses that we didn't anticipate or were greater than we thought. And you guys have literally been right there with us, and so it's allowed us to make this transition. And just want to thank you so much for all of your support. We couldn't be here if it wasn't for you. And you guys are just great, you know, fantastic. I know you. A lot of you are visual, so I'm just going to try to do this and not look silly. But, you know, basically, if you think about a train, you know, when it first started, it kind of sputters and stuff. And that's where we were. And it was driving Rafael Estrella, our director of finance, crazy because it would come really close some weeks. We're picking up a little bit of momentum now, getting in the groove. But we want to be, in the future, where we want to be is a nice, steady, smooth motion, you know, just moving, 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 choo-choo, you know? So we'll get there with your help. I'm going to ask Harry to come forward now.
Awesome. I want to see that little locomotive move again, if you don't mind. Hey, can I get a little help and pass these out? Yikes. I wanted to point out a couple of things as these brochures are coming around. What this does not mean, you know, when you look at the total income for all purposes, that includes all the building fund money, everything versus our expenses, is one thing that it doesn't mean is that there's like $300,000 laying around somewhere. What it means is that money is in the building. Right? We had so many new expenses associated with the building, finishing the project, and so that could be a little misleading if you're not careful. And I want to show you kind of where we are in terms of not just where we are, but where we hope to be. So this is, remember, we started 100X in 2014, and that was 2 years ago, so we have 1 year left. So for those of you that are new, it's a three-year building campaign that we started, and we raised over $300,000, and people have already given towards those pledges, over two-thirds of the amount of money that was pledged has already come in. We're expecting another 100 or so to come out. But if you take a look at this, you'll see, number one, notice the front cover. That's really what our front entrance is supposed to look like, right? That's what we hope it will look like one day. You know, they've been doing it in stages, but to get to that picture is probably another $500,000. Because you notice it's got that prayer tower and the signage and all that. Right now, our sign is a vinyl thing that we had made for several hundred dollars hanging on the side of the wall. And so you can tell we've put a lot of stuff off until we can afford it, right? But the one thing we always say is we want to prioritize the way we spend money with people, programs, and facilities in that order. So we try to make sure staff always get paid first, and then we focus on programs and then facilities. But this last year, 2 and 3 were really competing head-to-head. It was very difficult with all the new expenses and the unknowns of moving into the building. It's probably going to take us at least another year to figure that out. And so we're still learning. Even our power bill, we're still fighting with energy about it, that it was like $6,000 last month. And we're trying to get to a place where we can do a budget level billing kind of thing, so it's a known quantity every month. If you look at this picture right here, it's the one where the staff is at the top. What we're trying to do is raise around another $300,000. Some of that's included in last year's 100X campaign. So, but if first look at the staff picture. This is wherever I go and I speak, this is one of the first things I say is like, this is who we are as a church. And if you look at it, we're ethnically diverse, we're economically diverse, we're educationally diverse, we're politically diverse. We're even, to a certain degree, theologically diverse. I mean, there's no We're generationally diverse. There's just not a whole lot of slicing the staff up where you don't come up with a wide spectrum of perspective and diversity. And we love that. It's like it shows, you know, one of the most important characteristics of our church is to empower diverse leaders. Our elders, if you don't know who they are, you need to get to know who they are, because it's the same way. Eli is our chair this year. He's done a great job. Anthony is one of our newest elders. Mike Jeffrey is our, he's already rotated off, but he's still an elder. And we call on him a lot to do elder types of things. We had Tyler Churchy. He's kind of the young one. John Harrison, Tim James, and then Mark and myself. But basically, we're trying to raise $300,000 in cash and pledges to move ahead. 100 of that is already pledged from 2014. So really, we're talking about a couple hundred thousand dollars addition for this next year. So where's it all going to go? Well, if you turn to look at that next page. And by the way, this article that was written about us is straight off the website. It's one of the best articles ever written about the church, and so read that when you get a chance. But basically, where all that money is going to go is, number one, strengthen all our ministries and advance the ministries about $100,000 or so. And this is one of those line items where if it comes in, we do it, and if it doesn't come in, we don't do it, kind of thing. You know, because we'll have to cut if it doesn't come in, or just go without. We just keep pushing things down the road until we can afford to do it. Then notice we also still owe the architects $67,000. Okay, they did a whole lot of work for free, and they charged us about, 80-something thousand, and we've already paid them, I think, 20. But they just sent us an email, a day ago, going, is the rest of that money coming soon? And all we can say is we're praying it'll come in at the end of the year, and we're trying to raise money to pay it. But that's one of the most pressing obligations that we have. So there's that one. And then the security system, and don't tell anybody. Mike's telling me don't say it. We don't have a security system. Okay, so we're unprotected in that regard, and we really do need to have some kind of monitoring going on. I mean, there's just so much activity happening around the building at all hours, and it's really, it just is good stewardship. So we're still trying to get money to do that. Worship and sound, you guys know the issues we're having in this room, right, and how difficult it is here. We've already done some. We've hired Jonathan Chandler, and that's why, if it seemed any better, that's one of the reasons why, is because we have a full-on professional audio engineer back there tweaking all the knobs and making things happen that we didn't normally have. We're getting the room treated with those panels coming up towards the end of the year. But there's so much more we need to do in this room. Those speakers right there are not supposed to be used in the way they're supposed to be, the way they're being used. Those are monitors that typically sit on the stage and provide feedback sound for the musicians and the singers, and we just don't have anything else to hang, so we hung those. But really, we need to get better speakers, and if you have better speakers, you don't have to turn it up as much in order for it to fill the room. So that's where our hope is on all of that. There's a lot of different things regard to sound that we've just been keep pushing down the road until we can afford to do it. But those speakers, I know the originals were here when I got here in 2002. So they've been used well, and yeah, we've definitely gotten our money's worth out of all that stuff. And so that's that. That's a big issue. Also, we are trying to get some electrical infrastructure for the cafe and the warehouse. The warehouse is being lit, if you've ever walked through there, with just a bunch of halogen lights that are plugged in that we bought at Harbor Freight for $20. But they need to have real lights in there because the orchard walks in and out of there, and if you ever try to walk through there and when there's no lights, it's not really safe. We're also trying to get some infrastructure back there for the future kitchen. So that's in this round, and that's going to be anywhere around $15,000 or so. So that's kind of where all the money's going to go if we can raise it. There's plenty of more needs than that, so if you want to give more than that, feel free. And but you know, it's kind of like my role as senior pastor now involves having discussions about money. And that's one area that I have prayed the good Lord to give me more confidence in, because I hate talking about money. It's just it goes against my nature as a shepherd and a pastor. But I know, because I talk to all my other pastor friends, they talk about money. So I'm just going to have to get comfortable doing it. But I very humbly ask that you would pray and maybe just ask the Lord how he would have you donate according to your ability. What we always say is that, you know, it's not equal amounts, it's equal sacrifice. And we've had so many beautiful pictures of sacrifice that I'm sure leads to abundance that God has, how God has sustained us. We had people come in off the street and give us 11 cents as like an offering, you know, different times over the year. And I feel like every time we get one of those, it's like widow's mite. And I just keep looking for them. One time we've been taking up collections from the orchard. Get like, $20 just because they believe in us and they want us to succeed. And so they passed around a thing and gave us like $20. I feel like those are just such sacred dollars, you know, to see that from the community. So if you would consider in your giving above what you normally tithe and what you give regularly to the church, it would go a long, long way. Like I said, Rafa is extremely gifted, and I feel like we now have processes in place to where when you give money, it goes to what we need it for the most. We talk about all the time, every week we're talking about what needs to be spent, what needs to be pushed further down. So we're being as wise and as careful with what's coming in as we can. But make no mistake about it, we still need your support in every way possible. So my prayer is just simply that God will keep providing. He has, he will. That much I'm confident in. And I thank every one of you for what you've done for the church, regardless of the amount, because I know that many of you are sacrificing over and above. And it looks different in every heart, but I know that your hearts are so good for this ministry. Anyway, we're going to be around. The elders will be here, and we'll be glad to answer any of your questions. And what time is it? All right, so we got 5 minutes. Are there any questions? Anybody have any questions that you want us to address now? And then if not, we'll be glad to stick around. If you could, let us know. It'd be helpful if you did let us know if God has told you or led you to any kind of thing. It'd just be helpful to fill this out and let us know so that we can just count it. You know, it's one of the things we're trying to do more better of, is just measure things and keep a track of it. Any questions? Yeah.
I'll ask one that's really asked to me a minute.
Yeah, I'll just ask one that's been asked to me on a number of occasions, and they keep asking me, said, Mike, is there any plans for a midweek church Bible study?
Yeah, well, you know, we do have the classes on Monday night. Soul Sister meets on Wednesday nights, and we're talking about moving the Antioch Initiative, which is a full-fledged, it's a Bible study / college course that you can do either way. I have a bunch of people in my class on Monday night that are not seeking a degree. They're just there for the Bible study, and it is an encouraging class. I mean, we feel like we're almost to the point of falling on our faces at the end because it's just so encouraging. But yeah, Kai wants us to consider Wednesday night. We're thinking about moving Monday to Wednesday, but there's also women that are meeting on Wednesday nights, and there's some other talk about having stuff here on Wednesday night
as
well.
Soul Sisters has finished for this semester, but we are in discussion with Gary about doing an evangelism training course on Wednesday night. So it is in process, Mike.
Anyone else? Question? Yes.
I was just wondering about, many times I feel like pastors, anytime a congregation member needs something, I'm going to go ask Pastor so-and-so, and he'll take care of it for me. Is there a way, maybe on the website, to say questions about X go here? Or maybe that's already on the website, I don't know. But maybe to free y'all up from being bombarded by questions that might be easily answered by someone else or emailed. Is there a process there?
Want to take that? What we're doing, Tracy, thank you for that. We, in the interest of organizational excellence, we are becoming more clear about the staff organization. And what I usually do is, all of our deacons are now wearing name tags when they're here. They have been provided those to wear them. Go to a deacon first with those kind of things, because I do. I go to a deacon and ask them questions. So, but in the interest of organizational excellence, we will become better at that, and I'll like to talk to you about what you're suggesting for the website.
Joyce.
So if we are doing a payroll deduction, a deduction through our checking account, we can just easily go into what we're doing now. I remember doing it. I don't remember now how I get back to it to change it if I want to change it to make it different. So what's my process for doing that if I want to get to make the change?
Yeah, so to give to 100X, you need to go to the Push Pay or go on the website to give, and it's all real easy now. So she'll be able to do a regular reoccurring gift and a 100X gift at the same time, right, Mike? Yeah, and it's all real easy, and once you get it set up to do once. Yes.
We can stop that. Yeah, you just tell me you've done it, let me know, and we'll bring that to a close. The current thing, so you're in Push Pay with the new system. And you can just text Mosaic AR to 77977. They'll bounce you back a link.
Yeah, that's definitely the easiest thing. I used to do a recurring gift, and now just using Push Pay, it's like 2 seconds. Yeah, or I do both recurring and Push Pay.
Bishop has a question.
Yeah.
On this extra giving outside of your tithes, I'd like to know on your slip, you have others. Now, if that's going towards your billing fund or this extra, because it just says other.
All that means is it's another amount. It's all going to go towards what we call the 100X, which is the list that we just went over. Okay, so all this means is that if you have some other gift you want to
If you want to just go ahead and give $1 million, just write 1, 0,
million
0,
would
0,
go
0,
in
0,
other.
0, 0, 0 there.
The question is on your regular tithing. Besides tithing, what I'm trying to find out, if you want to give to this like on a monthly basis, instead of, you know, on your slip, you know, your regular tithing slip?
Mm-hmm.
Just fill it in. Okay.
Yeah, and Mike will be help you fill any of the adjustments or anything you have about how to give. Mike is the guy to ask about that. Anything else? Well, we'll be around, okay? And why don't we stand up? And I told this story at the end of the last one because somebody asked us, but it really shows you kind of like the relationship we have with the community. Because did you all know that the Fresh to You bus, like within the first week of operation, got broken into? And they stole almost $5,000 worth of stuff, including a very high-end generator and some other things. And it was really discouraging. But like the next Sunday, I'm in town hall and somebody says, hey, there's a guy over here who wants to talk to you. And this guy was standing there and I said, can I help you? And he goes, yeah, I just can't live with myself anymore. I'm one of the guys that pawned all your stuff. And here's where this is, your generator's at this one and your other thing's at this other thing. And yeah. And so then Paul went over and got all the stuff. He actually paid money to get one of the items out of pawn so that he wouldn't have to press charges against the guy that just confessed. But he told us who broke into the bus. And so we knew it, and this guy, he comes around to get food and stuff, and we didn't say anything for a while. In fact, Paul actually went and had a warrant taken out for him, and we were just waiting. But then, like, before that warrant could be executed, on another Tuesday, this was like 3 weeks ago, somebody said, hey, this guy wants to talk to you. And it was the guy that broke into the bus who said, I have to confess to you. I mean, he said, I was so desperate. I can't begin to tell you how desperate I was. And I'm the one that broke into your bus. And Paul and I were like, well, we knew it was you. We've known since the first week it was you. And he said, well, I didn't think anybody here around here knew. And I said, well, we could have had you arrested 10 times over by now if we really wanted to. And I said, but you know what? I forgive you. And he just looked at me with these eyes that were like, who are you and why are you here? And ever since then, he gives me a big hug whenever he, you know, shows up. And that whole community, I mean, they're here every Tuesday, and they know most all of us, you know, and we know most of them. And we just need to keep praying for them. You know, we have seen some end up, we will actually send people to rehab if they're willing down in New Orleans. And sometimes it really works out well. Anyway, grab a hand and let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Lord, we thank you so much for every person here. Thank you for their willingness to invest in this ministry. Thank you for all you've done to sustain this ministry and all you're going to do. And God, I know that the financial picture and the responsibility of it is a big weight, a lot that used to rest on Mark's shoulders, and now I'm understanding why he had such a hard time sleeping sometimes, now that it falls more on my shoulders. But I pray, God, you would just be a good God who continues to provide for his children and who are working to fulfill your purposes in this neighborhood. So bless every person, speak to us all, help us to be generous and good stewards of all that we do. We thank you and pray it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Thank you all.